Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Prawn of the Dead by Dakota Cassidy, narrated by Hollie Jackson. Chapter 1. Jessica Fletcher. Any idea why the door to the men's bathroom is ajar, young lady? I asked my monkey suspiciously as I tucked the keys to my convenience store's lavatory back inside the pocket of my hoodie. She, of course, looked at me as though I'd up and lost my mind on the way to do morning rounds. As though it were unseemly, I'd even consider she'd tampered with the keys. Jess is what's known as a spider monkey. 6 years old, with the attention span of an American 2-year-old, after a date with grandma and too much sugar. Plainly speaking, my little rescue monkey is a mischievous, quick-footed, tiny troublemaker who's alternately one of the great loves of my life and the bane of my very existence. Her name is a ridiculously obvious nod in honor of Angela Lansbury, and a tip of my ball cap to my father, the late great biker Chains Forney Layne. As a kid, after we'd set some catfish or brisket to smoke overnight for the following day, we religiously watched reruns of Murder, She Wrote over bags of salty cheese popcorn and cans of ice-cold grape soda from our coolers at our family-run gas station, convenience store, and, as crazy as this sounds, barbecue pit. It was our father and daughter jam, and one of the countless little things I missed most about him. I know he'd laugh that hearty, deep chuckle I was sure came from his very soul if he knew about Jessica. He'd loved Angela Lansbury, and a good mystery as much as I did, and still do. Chucking her under the chin, I pointed to the bathroom door and asked her again, "Is this the work of a certain primate?" JF repositioned herself on my shoulder, bracketing my face with her tiny hands, and looked deep into my eyes. This was her way of sincerely assuring me she was absolutely not the guilty party. But I know my Jess, and she'd more than once snatched the keys off the hook above the cash register the second I was even a little distracted. Despite the fact that spider monkeys have very short thumbs and long hook-like fingers, she's quite adept with them and uses them to her full advantage. Not to mention that prehensile tail of hers. She's always yanking items off shelves and scooping up shiny things that catch her fancy. So I narrowed my gaze at her and warned, "I'm just saying, if I find out it was you." JF made a dramatic plunge backward and fell along the length of my shoulders, curling her tiny head in toward my face. In typical theatrical Jess fashion, she threw her hand across her eyes and stuttered a weak chirp. Nodding my head, I muttered a somber, "That's absolutely right. You'll be dead meat for 100, JF. Then I grinned at her. I couldn't help it. Even though she was likely the culprit, she was too darn cute to resist. My phone rang to the tune of Beethoven, indicating my best friend, Coco Belinski, calling for our usual early morning chat. Monday through Friday, it was a ritual for us to start our day off with a good gab, our way of keeping in touch when I'd moved away to Seattle. A promise we kept so we'd never lose touch, and one we continued with the utmost reverence since I'd moved back. I dug my phone out of the pocket of my sweats and clicked the accept button and leaned against the cool brick wall right beside the bathroom while Jessica fussed with her new t-shirt. Distractedly, I wrapped one of my annoying curls around my index finger and shoved it out of my face. "Morning, Coco." Facing the thicket of tall trees across the street lining our country road, I smiled and inhaled the chilly breeze rolling in from the ocean. January was here, and it was evident in the salty tang of the air. Harbor bells rang to signify incoming fishing boats, the early morning echo music to my ears. While the phone connection crackled, I scuffed my foot on the wide curb leading from the entry of the storefront all the way around to our connecting bathrooms on the right side of the building. "How's Lemon Layne's world today?" Coco finally asked, coming through surprisingly loud and clear, her liquid smooth voice far too cheerful for 7 a.m. I pictured my friend since preschool, her dark hair cut at a fashionable angle along her jaw, straight and gleaming, her right hand latched on to her left biceps as she paced the length of her office at the coroner's in a trendy outfit, complemented by a bright scarf. There was almost nothing she loved more than a scarf. We, as a pair, are quite the opposite. While Coco's hair and clothes are fashionable and chic, my hair is unruly and brown, with highlights of auburn streaked throughout. Not intentionally, mind you. They're just there naturally, tucked amongst a massive mess of curls I'm forever trying to tame. And as far as fashion goes, I don't think Cosmo's calling. But I might have a shot at Field and Stream. Lemon? You still there? Lemon Layne's world is exactly the same as it was last night when she sat up way too late yakking on the phone with her best friend about who the new boat in the harbor belongs to while they watched mindless TV. Coco giggled, soft and melodic. That's what I love most about you, Lemon. You're steadfast and true. Speaking of steadfast, or dog with a bone, however you want to label it, found any new mysteries to solve today? Like, who's been stealing all the Ho Hos from the center aisle of the station? If anyone can figure it out, it's you. Coco was referring to the smoke and petrol, which I mentioned earlier. My family-owned combination gas station slash convenience store slash best smoked catfish barbecue pit in Fig Harbor, Washington, that I run with my mother. Smoking meat, especially catfish, was another passion my dad handed down to me. Every time I rubbed down a catfish with our secret recipe of spices, or when I made a batch of our sweet and spicy homemade barbecue sauce for our brisket, I felt my dad right there next to me, showing me the tricks of the trade he'd learned in his extensive biker travels. I chuckled into the phone. My best friend of 30-some-odd years knew me so well. A mystery, any mystery, really, big or small, was rather like my nemesis of sorts. I couldn't keep my nose out of it until I figured it out. But my sleuthing also made me feel closer to my dad. It kept the memory of the twinkle in his eye alive whenever I set my mind to figuring out who'd done it. Everything I've learned about being a nosy amateur puzzle solver came from him. We'd had a rash of recent petty thefts by someone who appeared to really enjoy the edgy coup of heisting a chocolate-covered spongy treat. Whoever it was, he was slicker than a vat of fry oil because I still hadn't caught the culprit. Nope, still haven't figured out who's desperate enough to steal Ho-Hos in bulk, but I'm on it, I assured her with a grin, waving to one of my favorite locals, Nita Burns, as she drove by on her way to open up her floral shop. So, how's the new fish doing this morning? Coco meant my new white koi fish I'd just integrated into the pond in the backyard of the house my mother and I shared. The pond and my exotic fish tank are my zen, my monk chants, if you will. Rain or shine, when I'm overwhelmed or just need to think, that's usually where you can find me. I'm tickled all sorts of pink to announce Koi George is still alive and swimming. Yay. You've had some tough luck with the pond fish lately. Glad to hear George is adjusting to his new environment. The cold winter rain began to pelt my face, forcing me to take off my glasses, tuck them in my sweats pocket, and acknowledge the task at hand. Cleaning the station's bathroom. We didn't just make the best barbecue catfish in town, we had the cleanest gas station bathrooms too. Lemon, you still there? Still here, I said, and waited for her response. Instead, I only heard the crackle of our intermittent connection. Coco? Dang, lost her again. Phone reception here in our small town of Fig Harbor is spotty from time to time. Surrounded by ocean and tall trees and backed by a mountain, our slice of heaven sometimes makes for a cell phone nightmare. As I waited for Coco to call back, which, as always, she'd undoubtedly do, I pushed off the wall with my foot, tucked my phone back into my pocket, and used my elbow to shove the door to the bathroom open. When the gloomy light of a typical rainy Pacific Northwest day fell across the bathroom's tile floor, I gasped in horror. A gasp so sharp, Jessica clung to my head and buried her face in the neck of my hoodie. I blinked my eyes, then blinked again as my throat constricted. My heart began to crash in my chest and my ears pounded with the throb of my rushing pulse. Oh, for sure he was. There was no way. Dead. Spit and fire, there was a dead man on the floor. Holy sweet and spicy catfish, I muttered. Not that something as trivial as tender catfish and fall-off-the-bone ribs are at all important at a sensitive time like this, but in times of distress, my brain deviates to familiar comforts like barbecue and cars. Barbecue just happens to be one of my go-tos. That, and a good wheel alignment, always soothe my unsettled inner beast. The man's torso was sprawled at an awkward angle just outside the stall where he lay on his belly, with his left cheek pressed to the tile floor and a dead prawn by his right shoulder. His long legs were still half inside the stall at the front of the toilet as though someone had launched him from their shoulder like a sack of potatoes. The newly painted white stall door stood wide open, hanging crookedly on its hinges. I knelt down to see if he was breathing, though rationally I knew that couldn't be possible. And that's when I realized who it was. I'd know that silver high school football ring with the sapphire square in it almost anywhere. He'd bragged about it at nearly every dinner I'd ever shared with him. It was Myron Fairbanks, my mother's ex-boyfriend. Rising, I reached for the top of the stall door. I needed something to anchor me in order to stay upright as I stared down at him. Blood. You would think there would be more, but Myron's light blue members-only jacket was covered in mere crimson spatters, a mesmerizing Rorschach of patterns. Somehow, in his condition, I would have expected a coppery pool surrounding his body. Only one dark brown orthopedic shoe remained on his right foot, and the shoelace was untied. The left I thought was missing entirely until I spotted it by the corner of the wall. Yet it wasn't his clothes that troubled me as much as the dark splotch in his hair at the back of his head. I clenched my eyes shut and forced them open again, unable to look away from the spot on his skull. For a man Myron's age, he had amazing, snowy white hair, but those luscious locks were now merely the resting place for what had likely killed him. A hole in his skull, approximately 4 inches in diameter, with what looked like a piece of his brain missing, was the likely culprit. My throat tightened momentarily in a gag reflex, and my heart picked up its pace as I forced myself to breathe and focus. I've been described as almost eerily calm in times of crisis. This was definitely a crisis, and I definitely needed to be calm. I looked to Jessica Fletcher perched on my shoulder, her sharp eyes watching mine while I reached into the pocket of my sweats and dug out a pair of sterile gloves and slipped them on. At the moment, I was grateful I always kept gloves on me. With a gas station frequented mostly by fishermen and touristy teenage boys who buy $2 worth of gas to fill their jet skis just to use the facilities, they come in handy. Squatting on my haunches again, I double-checked Myron's pulse to be sure I wasn't wrong. Logically, I knew there was no way I could be wrong after seeing what was right in front of me. But a sudden, irrational fear he would rise from the floor like the living dead and witness the condition he was in via the long mirror on the back of the entrance door made me recheck. Because he was in quite a state. Still, there was nothing. How had this happened? When had it happened? Had Jessica somehow nabbed the keys and opened the bathroom door this morning? That was impossible. She'd been in her cage when I'd left to grab some coffee in town and remained there until I'd arrived back at the station to do my morning bathroom checks. I scanned the small area, my eyes roaming over every inch of the crisp white tile floors, the porcelain sink, the pale blue walls my mother and I had chosen the paint color for together. The sink was dry, the mirror mostly free of the speckles of water I spent so much time cleaning. Almost nothing aside from the crooked stall door was disturbed, which I found incredibly disturbing. I ran the back of my wrist over my forehead as I rose with caution, careful not to upset anything more than I'd already disturbed just by nature of finding the body, then clenched my eyes shut to block out the vision of Myron. I backed away and walked to the front door's entryway, gulping in the damp outside air of the new day as I prepared to call 911. I wanted to compose myself so I didn't scream out in haste, "There's been a murder!" The shrill sound of Coco calling again made me jump. In that bizarre moment of pulsing, broken silence, I lost all sense of reason. When I should be calling 911, I was instead accepting Coco's call. I needed to tell someone. I needed to purge what I saw by way of words, cleanse it from my palate, lift the enormous weight pressing on my chest. "He's dead!" I shouted into the phone, like an exploding champagne cork, before I thought to temper my words with a statement she'd find less jarring. "Coy George? The new whitefish? Jeez, oh Pete. In the 5 minutes since we..." The phone began that erratic crackle once more, making me want to shake it. You're cutting in and out again. Stop pacing. You know what that does to our reception. The fish isn't dead, Coco. The man is. Wait. You lost me. I only heard man. Oh, wait. Coy George is a man? You know, I've always wondered how you know if the fishy is a boy or a girl. Do they have tender bits you can see for gender identification? Coy George isn't dead, Coco. She breathed an impatient breath of air into the phone. Right now, I'd bet dollars to donuts she had a hand on her hip with one of her perfectly plucked eyebrows arched in haughty indignation. Then why are you yelling at me? I fought my rising frustration about our shoddy connection by pressing my knuckles to my forehead right over my very imperfectly plucked eyebrow. Because I just found Myron Fairbanks on the floor of the men's bathroom here at the station, and I'm a little freaked out. He's on the floor? Oh, dang. Is he hurt? I fought not to throw my phone across the vast parking lot of the station. But do insert a really bad word here because I wanted to use the baddest word I could find to vent my frustration. No! I mean, yes, he's on the floor, Coco, but he's also... Well, then, help him the heck up, Lemon. Quite suddenly, her voice boomed loudly, an indicator the line had cleared. At least for the moment. Holy spitballs, Myron's 100 if he's a day. His bones are well past the supple stage and deep into as brittle as the ends of my hair. You can't just leave him there. You think it was a heart attack? Or maybe a stroke? I shook my head as though Coco could see me, my lips sticking to my teeth. No. It wasn't a heart attack or a stroke. So you're Dr. Layne now? Did you get your medical license when I wasn't looking? How do you know what's wrong with him? I groaned, my stomach in a tight knot. Coco! Stand still and listen carefully. Coy George is fine. Myron Fairbanks isn't on the floor because he fell. He's on the floor because he's dead. So dead. I winced and shuddered. Coco gasped. Finally, I'd elicited a reaction worthy of this horrible news. I pictured her now, settling in at her desk at the local coroner's office, her long, graceful fingers tugging at her lower lip, a telltale sign she was nervous and fretting. How awful, Lemon. Oh, this is so tragic, she moaned, her tone syrupy sweet with sympathy. Now that I'd vented, I remembered what needed to be done. Coco, I really have to go. I have to call 9... Noise from behind me sent shivers up my spine. Jessica. Oh, crud. She'd somehow managed to climb down off my shoulder while I was testing out the validity of Myron's mortality, and I hadn't even noticed. But, in my defense, I just found a man with a chunk of his skull and brains missing. That would distract even the most focused. I whipped back around toward the bathroom door, moving the phone from my mouth. A rustling sound from the left side of the stall beside the toilet and just beyond where Myron's body lay grew stronger. Horror-stricken, I sputtered, "No! Put that down! Please don't!" "Lemon?" Coco belted out, alarm clear in her tone as she tapped the phone with her fingernail. "Hey, what's wrong? What happened? Lemon, you answer me this second! You're freaking me out with all this talk of dead people!" Then she gasped again, a wheezing intake of breath as she wound up. Hold on. Dead plus not a heart attack or stroke equals... Sweet petunias. Did someone kill Myron? Oh, my giddy aunt. Is the killer there? Is he holding you hostage and forcing you to hang up? Is that why you have to go? Lemon Layne, you know our code word, the one we promised to use if we were ever taken hostage with no way out and we wanted to say one last goodbye. If there's a murderer with a gun to your head, you'd better use it so I can save you. Our code word was Twizzlers. We loved them. Cherry and cherry only. We made it up when we were 8 after we snuck in to see Friday the 13th at the old Cineplex in the middle of downtown Fig. We were convinced Jason was going to snatch us up in our sleep for years after that. Plus, we thought if we used an odd out-of-context word, it would throw a killer off long enough for us to possibly attempt escape and or at least puzzle our captor so one of us could get help. Lemon, answer me. Before I had the chance to respond to her properly, I looked at Myron's body and promptly forgot Coco and our Twizzler farewells. Lemon? No! Twizzler, stop! I managed to spout a jumble of words as they came to mind before I let the hand holding my phone fall to my side and look down at the floor. A mound of toilet paper had begun to magically rise on the tiled floor beside Myron's body, courtesy of none other than my mischievous Jessica Fletcher. I'd been so caught off guard when I found Myron lying on his face, I'd been remiss about the warning I always repeated when we cleaned the bathrooms at the beginning of each day. No toilet paper, young lady. I was paying for that right now by way of an almost empty roll of Charmin she'd extracted from the dispenser. Toilet paper was JF's crack, an addiction she'd been in Lemon's rehab for on more than one occasion, and my little beast of burden was quick and light of foot. The moment I became distracted was the moment she became a tiny, maniacal terrorist of two-ply with ridges. Lemon! Are you still there? You keep fading in and out. What's happening? Talk to me. Coco paused briefly while I squeezed into the stall between the wall and the toilet like I was auditioning for Cirque du Soleil in an effort to avoid touching Myron. That is, of course, before I remembered I was still contaminating the crime scene. But there was no going back now. As I reached for my ill-behaved precious, Coco yelped, "That's it. I'm calling 911. The Coast Guard. Whoever. Just hang tight and stay on the line with me." I ignored Coco and chastised, "Jessica Fletcher, don't you dare make another move. Drop that now." "Who has what? Does he have Jessica Fletcher too?" Coco's hysteria-riddled question was muffled against my thigh. "Oh, jeez. You're cutting in and out again, Lemon, but if you can hear this, tell Jessica to bite that smarmy murderer's face off. Get him, JF! Go all Planet of the Apes!" she bellowed, the frenzy in her voice growing. "No, Coco, there's no murderer!" I yelled as loud as my lungs would allow in an attempt to reassure her. I didn't have the chance to explain further. I was too busy trying to corner Jessica in the back of the stall behind the toilet like a sumo wrestler stalks his opponent, my knees bent with my arms and hands at 3 and 9 o'clock. If I didn't catch her, she'd royally screw up any possible evidence I hadn't already screwed up. But JF happily danced beside the back of the toilet, squeaking and chirping her delight. So I stopped all motion and gave her the evil eye, the one that said I meant dire business. I held out my hand to encourage her to climb up my arm, trying not to touch Myron's now thoroughly teepeed body because he looked like a tree on senior night at one of the high school cheerleaders' houses. "Jessica, come to Mama. Light of my life, center of my universe, please, please, please come to Mama," I cooed again good-naturedly, if not a bit desperately, hoping the tone of my voice would reassure her she wasn't in too much trouble. I saw her toy with the idea of obeying me. It was in the quick cock of her tiny head and the dart of her eyes. And then she decided in favor of more shenanigans. So I opted to change tactics and glared at her. Hard. My petite primate squealed her pleasure with high-pitched chirps and her customary hop from one foot to the other. I had to get her away from Myron's body soon before she soiled something that could turn out to be important. Sometimes she has accidents if she's too worked up, and on top of everything else, we didn't need monkey excrement in the mix. Jessica draped a length of the toilet paper around her neck, fashioning it into a feather boa and holding it proudly for me to see. JF loved to dress up, and today was no exception. Also, she was no stranger to improv. She could make a boa out of dental floss and a popsicle stick, given some time. "Jessica, that is not one of your boas. Put it down now," I warned, letting my voice go low with authority. She finally stopped for a moment and looked up at me, all heart-meltingly adorable monkey eyes and brown twitchy ears, as though I had an overdeveloped sense of chutzpah to even consider she not investigate this unusual turn of events in our morning routine with as much toilet paper as she could manage to unwind around poor Myron's legs. I narrowed my gaze in her direction and shook my finger before I made a jerky, uncoordinated attempt to snatch her roll of booty away by bending at the knees and bracing myself on the toilet seat with the heel of the hand I held my phone in. But instead of nabbing Jess, I slipped on some of the flimsy paper she'd decorated the body with and pitched sideways, hitting the side of my forehead on the edge of the metal dispenser. My head popped back up like a whack-a-mole at the sharp contact, and then a stream of blood began to drip down the side of my face, hot and wet, landing on the leg of my sweats in perfect crimson droplets. I saw a few stars before I was able to refocus enough to tisk my disapproval at Jessica Fletcher. Blood. Perfect. Dang it, Jess. These were new sweats, and now I have blood on me. Blood? Coco. Shoot. I'd forgotten she was still on the line. Naturally, now when chaos ensued, our connection was crystal clear. Why am I hearing that noun? Did he hurt you, Lemon? If I get my hands on him. Just you hang on. Help is on the way. I heard Coco scream, half a second before I lost the grip on my phone and dropped it in the toilet. The water splashed up and outward in a splooshy wave of blue, disinfected wetness. I leaned forward, bracing my elbows on the toilet seat and let my head hang down in defeat. And that's when the sensor to the toilet went off, successfully sucking my phone down the vortex of swirling blue water. With a groan, I lifted my head and shot Jessica a glare so hard I thought for sure my eyes would fall out of my skull. What would Angela Lansbury say if she could see how we've defiled this crime scene, miss? Jessica squeaked a protest at me, throwing her makeshift paper boa over her tiny shoulders seconds before Justice Carver barreled his way through the bathroom's door and pointed a gun into the stall right at me. His name really is Justice, and as Coco and I always joke, he really does do justice to such a big, rather imposing name.
Police, don't move. Put your hands where I can see them.
His handsome face, sharply angled, defined by high cheekbones, deep grooves on either side of his mouth, and brown eyes the color of nutmeg, was a mask of fierce, hawk-like intensity. The frigid January wind blew his dark, thick hair around his face and made his cheeks ruddy with color. I threw my hands up as ordered. Jessica backed away and dropped the toilet paper roll in obvious guilt, putting her hands up too. The little traitor. My breath came in panicked gasps for air. But I wasn't 100% sure whether it was because the barrel of a gun was pointed at my face or because of Justice himself.
Where is he?
Justice whispered, his eyes scanning the small interior of the bathroom with one sweep of a glance. My thighs were killing me, hunched down like I was. Who? Myron? I squeaked.
No, the murderer, Lemon.
What murderer? Justice sighed and rolled his eyes, his wide shoulders slouching to a more relaxed position. He sounded almost disappointed when he said,
"There's no murderer, is there?"
Of that, I wasn't quite sure. Myron certainly hadn't cut a hole in his own head. My mind began to race, as it typically does when something needs solving, and Myron was definitely in need of a good solving. I wondered if maybe a murderer really was on the loose and Justice knew something I didn't know. I could conclusion hop just as well as Coco and her imaginary murderer. The difference being, I kept my outlandish theories on the inside. Well, there's no murderer here in the bathroom. What murderer are you talking about? I hedged, hoping he'd offer up some secret police information the public at large wasn't privy to just yet.
The one Coco called me about in hysterics. The one she said was holding you hostage, for Pete's sake. She said something about Twizzlers and code words. I don't know. She was a wreck. Most of it was hard to make out except the part about a murderer holding you hostage here at the gas station.
I really, really love Coco, but sometimes her vivid imagination and penchant for taking a molehill and turning it into Mount Rainier made me want to put duct tape over her mouth. Can I put my hands down now? Because I felt dizzy. Again, not entirely sure if that was because I'd hit my head or because the barrel of a gun was pointed at my face. He held out a strong, sun-browned hand to help me up.
Course you can, Lemon. Coco made it sound like the guy had a gun to your head. The second she called, I raced right over here. I think I might have knocked over Doty's donut shop sandwich board pulling out of her parking lot when I got the call. I know for sure I left a couple of stray surfers soaked from the puddles. I sped along the back road beside the beach like some maniac.
Justice holstered his gun, almost looking disappointed there was no rabid killer on the loose.
Backup should be here any second.
Jessica scooted past me and gripped the leg of Justice's trousers, scurrying her way up along his body until she sat on his shoulder. She promptly began to groom him, using her long fingers to comb through his wet hair as he pumped some paper towels from the wall dispenser and handed them to me for my wound. J.F. especially loved Justice. Well, mostly all men, if I'm honest. She's quite the flirty McFlirt. But whenever he came into the station store to order a chopped brisket sandwich for lunch, Jessica somehow finagled her way into his lap while he waited. I flushed my phone down the toilet. I'm not sure why I said that. Maybe because I always felt awkward and clumsy around Justice, who was like a gazelle and I didn't know what else to say. His lips lifted in a half smile while he compliantly tilted his head to allow Jess to check his ears.
That could be why Coco thinks you're dead. Though you are bleeding, Lemon. What happened?
Justice lifted a hand to move the hair from my face and examine my toilet paper dispenser mishap. I'd like to tell you it was because I fought off a diabolical senior-killing ninja like some kind of gladiator. Alas, not so much. I hit my head on the dispenser trying to get Jess out of the stall before she did any more damage. Justice leaned in close to me, enough that I smelled his spicy cologne and his minty breath, and lifted the paper towels I compressed to my head.
Looks kind of deep, Lemon. I think you might need stitches.
I made myself as small as possible against the front of the stall and diverted his attention to Myron's body. Not as badly as Myron needs them. Justice squatted beside Myron, using a pen from his pocket to shift some of the toilet paper around until he saw the very thing that had me puzzled from the moment I'd checked Myron for a pulse. I knew he'd seen it when he looked up at me, because his brown eyes were perplexed.
What the blazes?
I shivered in response, clenching my hands together in my hoodie's center pocket. Yeah, that's what I wondered too.
There's a piece of...
He swallowed hard, his Adam's apple bobbing above the collar of his navy blue uniform.
I mean, somebody.
Cut a chunk of his skull out and took a piece of his brain when they murdered him? Justice nodded, his face grim.
Yeah, that. Hey, didn't your mom and Myron break up not long ago?
About 4 months ago, why? He looked up at me then, one eyebrow raised.
Because as I recall, she threatened to kill him for cheating on her.
I swallowed hard. Yeah, that. Chapter 2. As I stood outside the bathroom with Justice and Chief Ainsley Burroughs, Coco pulled up in her little red Golf, screeching to a gravel-spitting halt. She flew at me the second her high-heeled feet hit the ground after exiting her car. Lemon! She cried, throwing her arms around my neck and burying me in a cloud of warm vanilla sugar perfume and gray and pink scarf. Oh, thank the stars you're okay. She lifted my chin, her green eyes widening when she caught sight of the cut on my forehead. He hit you, didn't he? That son of a dirty, rotten, dumpster-diving slimeball. Where is he? Is he in handcuffs? He'd better be. Oh, you can bet I'm going to let him have a good look at my fist just before I... Coco! I gripped her shoulders and looked at her through the film of light rain that had begun to fall. Easy, Holyfield. There is no murderer. Or, more accurately, there wasn't one yet. No one scooped a decent enough man's brains out of his head if murder wasn't involved. Her pretty face.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.